Hi, the subject of my Sunday school lesson today is how rock and roll and popular music influenced the civil rights movement. It's going to come off a lot like a class, and I'm sorry, but it's the way it goes. The white audiences in the United States have been entertained by black performers almost since the country's founding. President John Adams, back in the 1800s, is known to have preferred the harmonically complex and polyrhythmic padding juba of the spirituals sung by the local slaves to the droned-out Protestant hymns, like braying asses, as he said, in one steady beat. Clubs around the country filled their halls with well-paying white audiences, eager to hear Count Basie, Louis Armstrong, Cab Calloway, Lionel Hampton, and of course, Duke Ellington. But it wasn't until the babies of the 1940s became the teens of the 1950s that music became more than entertainment and actually initiated social change. What we know about rock and roll is actually, what we know as rock and roll is actually an amalgamation of many different styles of music. Music of the slaves, their work songs, their songs from their worship, and songs that they would sing in the evenings for entertainment. Bluegrass music from Appalachia and Western cowboy songs, that's just among a few. Its migration from the porches of the sharecropper shack in the South follows the migration of the blacks from the agricultural South to the industrial North after, during, and after World War II, to cities like Chicago, Memphis, Detroit, and Philadelphia. The music, of course, came with them in the form of the blues. Authentic blues was played on acoustic instruments, mostly because they didn't have electricity where they came from, and the instruments were usually homemade. Upon arrival into the cities, these former farmers found work in factories and slaughterhouses, in munition and auto plants. They were earning comparatively good wages, and for the first time ever had disposable income. They were no longer content with the simple, probably homemade instruments of their southern lives, and they looked for more sophisticated sounds. Enter Les Paul and the electrified guitars. With their new income, these transplanted southerners opened dinner and dance clubs within their communities where they could go and enjoy an evening hearing familiar tunes played in new ways with these new instruments. Performers like Bo Diddley, Muddy Waters, and Howlin' Wolf became popular within the black communities. It wasn't just the blues now, it was rhythm and blues. Of course, all the clubs were segregated. Since black patrons were limited in where they could go to hear this music, many recording companies sprang up to fill a void. Leonard and Phil Chess, Ahmet Ertegun, and Jerry Wexler were successful in finding artists and establishing studios around metropolitan areas, allowing black performers to record their music for people outside the cities, earning the performers not only some extra money, but a broader fan base.
Gypsy woman told my mother, before I was born, you got a boy child coming, gonna be a son of a gun, gonna make pretty women jump and shout, then the world wanna know what this all about, but you know I'm here. I'm here. Well, you know, man. Everybody knows I'm here. I got a black cat bone. I got a mojo too. I got the John the Conqueror. I'm gonna mess with you. I'm gonna make you guess. Leave me by my hand. Then the world will know that I'm a hoochie coochie man. But you know I'm here. Everybody knows I'm here. Everybody knows of you. On the seventh day, on the seventh month, the seventh doctor said, we're born for good luck. At that you see, I got $700. Don't you mess with me, but you know I'm here. Everybody knows I'm here.
That's all right. That's all right. That's all right.
these men soon realized that with one simple invention, this race music could reach a far wider audience. The transistor radio made it possible for teens and college students to access this new sound. I'm telling you all this to give you some background history of the genre that is now known as rock and roll. The people mentioned above and others became the influencers of Chuck Berry and Little Richard and Fats Domino, who became the influencers for Mick Jagger and the Beatles and people who came after. Now, how does all this fit into the civil rights? What part does the transistor radio play? And does TV have a place in this story? Well, after World War II, televisions became more popular and more affordable. They needed programming. Who's got the programming? Radio had programming. They had long-running, well-established dramas and comedies, which could easily be translated in to fill the void in television, leaving radio with a void. Well, they needed to fill it. They needed to fill this airtime. The radio audience is quickly tired of hearing the same white performers, the McGuire sisters, the Andrew sisters, Benny Goodman, Glenn Miller, Mitch Miller, and the like. They all sounded alike after a while. Advertisers were losing business because people were not listening to the radio. And if people tuned out and the advertisers lost business, the radio stations lost business. Disc jockeys scrambled to find fresh new sounds to keep the listeners tuned in. They were especially interested in the new crop of teens as an audience. Teens had the money. One DJ in particular, Alan Freed, began to ceaselessly market to this new teenage audience. He organized racially integrated rock and roll concerts in Cleveland area, where they were met with great enthusiasm. Now, when I say integrated, think the movie Hairspray. Black and whites are in the same space, but there's a rope in the middle, and you didn't cross on this side, and you didn't cross on that side. There was most likely sections of each roped off. That changed with one particular concert, which got a little out of hand. The Moondog Coronation Ball. The concert was held in an auditorium designed for 9,000 people. It's a pretty big venue. But it was so popular that 18,000 people showed up. The concert eventually was canceled, but Freed was not a stupid man. He saw the direction music was going and quickly became the DJ to listen to as he promoted R&B artists and even this newer music that he called rock and roll.
Roll on!
young teens listened to Freed and other rock and roll playing DJs on their transistor radios that they could easily purchase with their babysitting money or their money from their after-school jobs. Baby boomer teens were becoming an economic force that would last to this day. Cars, too, were becoming equipped with radios. And while race music might be discouraged at home on the family RCA stereo, there was little to stop these teens from listening to their music on their radios or in their cars with their friends. Performers, too, were realizing the potential for their music to reach larger, more diverse audiences. Chuck Berry and Little Richard began flexing their musical muscle. If venues wanted them to perform, it had to be on their terms, meaning integrated audiences. These were the days of Ruby Bridges, Elizabeth Eckford, and James Meredith. Separate but Equal was crumbling. Teens were interacting with people of different ethnic backgrounds more frequently and more easily. Music continued to be a common ground upon which they could stand. Gradually, the walls started breaking down. Black club owners started having white nights where white audiences would come and hear the latest black performers. White audiences, perhaps with some poetic justice, would be crammed into the back corners or up in the balconies, the way the blacks had been crammed into the balconies and back corners of the white clubs. Rope lines might be used to keep the races physically apart, but it didn't stop the white customers from hearing and seeing black performers or the way the black audiences reacted to these performers, dancing, moving to the beats, and of course they copied them. According to Ralph Bass, a music producer with Chess Records, then the ropes would come down and they'd be dancing together. You know, it was a revolution. Music did it. We did as much with the music as the Civil Rights Act and all of the marches for breaking down the race barrier. So they realized that just their presence was having an effect on how the black community was being viewed by the greater white audiences. There was a problem, though. As any physics teacher will tell you, with every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. While teens bought the records and listened to the music on the radio, parents were up in arms over their children being seduced by more overt sexual overtones of the music of the black performers. More worrisome for some was finding their daughters with posters of the black performers plastered to their walls. They remembered their feelings for performers like Dean Martin and Bing Crosby and other performers, Perry Como, of the 1940s. And they weren't real sure they liked their children feeling those same things for these performers. This created a backlash against the performers and the radio stations that played their music. Boycotting businesses and burning records was a common reaction, especially in the South. But as anyone who's ever worked with children, anyone with an ounce of insight will tell you, when you start telling people, especially teens, what they can and can't do, you can pretty much be assured that what you don't want them to do will be the exact thing they will do.
And it went quite high in the American charts. The title of it is Maybelline. Oh, Maybelline, can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true? You started back doing the things you used to do. As I was motivating over the hill, I heard that highway sound. Cadillac setting like a ton of lead, 110 half a mile ahead. Cadillac looked like setting still, and I caught Maybelline on the top of the hill. Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, can't you be true? You done started back doing the things you used to do.
Merci beaucoup.
The music executives, seeing this, saw only one way out. They needed to find a white boy who sounded black. Or at the very least, get white performers to cover black music. My cat is a critic here. Enter Elvis Presley. Elvis walked into Sun Studios in Memphis to record a few songs for Sam Phillips. Phillips initially was unimpressed and left the recording booth, but left the tape running. Elvis and his band, seeing their chances slip away, decided to cut loose on a song by black performer Arthur Big Boy Crudup, a blues tune called That's All Right, Mama. That evening, as Philip was listening to the tapes, he knew he'd found the next big thing. The floodgates had been opened, and white performers, many of whom had grown up in the South around blacks and their music, started to find their way to studios like Sun to take their shot at fame. Many singing covers of previously recorded black singers, usually without attribution. The funniest, musically speaking, is the image of a clean-cut 1950s crooner, Pat Boone, singing Tutti Frutti. He changed some of the more sexually explicit words to something he felt was more acceptable to white audiences and to fit his image. And he's standing there with his collar undone, his tie undone, and he's snapping his fingers on beats 1 and 3. He looks for all the world as if he's having a spasm. So we're gonna play Pat Boone doing Tutti Frutti and the original recording of Hound Dog by Willie Mae Thornton, and then Elvis's Hound Dog by Willie Mae Thornton. So.
Tutti Frutti, oh Rudy. Tutti Frutti, oh Rudy. Ooh, Tutti Frutti, oh Rudy. Tutti Frutti, oh Rudy. Tutti Frutti, oh Rudy. Wop-bop-a-loom-bop-a-bop-bop-bop. I got a gal, her name's Daisy. Oh, looks like you're crazy. I got a gal, her name's Daisy. Oh, looks like you're crazy. She's a milk on cookie, yes siree. Bird and little Susie is the gal for me. Tootie Fruity, oh Rudy. 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 Wop-bop-a-loom-bop-a-lop-bam.
Swooping out, huh? And bring on with a big round of applause.
Yeah, I feel real good. I just want to let everybody know all about it. You ain't nothing but a
Hey. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, girl. You cry all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit, and you ain't no friend of mine. Well, they said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, they said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, you ain't never caught a rabbit, and you ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound.
I giggle every time I see Pat Boone. As the 1960s progressed, Black entrepreneurs began opening studios to record Black artists. Foremost among them was Motown Records, owned and operated by Berry Gordy. Where before Black artists were left to develop their own style and sound, Gordy actively guided his stable of performers, who were mostly kids from around the neighborhoods around Detroit, in everything from he instructed them in how to dress, how to speak, how to act, what fork to use, how to stand, everything, to make them more socially accepted. And by socially, I mean white socially accepted, to essentially meet the queen. That's what his goal was. The music industry itself was going through some growing pains. There are two organizations, one ASCAP, A-S-C-A-P, which stands for American Society of Composers and Arrangers. That was the music licensing organization that published music by composers. The composers and arrangers would sell their songs to performers, with ASCAP acting as a middleman and taking a percentage of the fees paid for the music. BMI, or Broadcast Music Incorporated, set itself up as a competitor by representing and licensing music written by people who actually performed the music. ASCAP represented people like Rodgers and Hammerstein, Lerner and Lowe, and the songwriters of Tin Pan Alley, like Carole King and Neil Sedaka. BMI represented Chuck Berry, Little Richard, and other performers who created and performed their own music. Frequently, the music of the Black performers would be used without permission, i.e. stolen, and used without attribution. Think the Beach Boys ripping off Chuck Berry in Surfing USA, or Little Richard's lawsuit for $112 million back in the 1980s. suing for illegal use of his music and back royalties. That wasn't settled, by the way, until 1986. And now we're going to listen to the Beach Boys ripping off Chuck Berry on Surfing USA.
If everybody had an ocean across the USA, then everybody'd be surfing like California. You'd see them wearing their baggies, Huarache sandals too, a bushy, bushy blonde hairdo, surfing USA. You'll catch them surfing at
tell, there's a lot more I could add. I've shortened some things and didn't mention others. Essentially, what I want you to get out of this is music has acted like water as an eroding factor on society as it stood. It allowed people to see humanity in those they otherwise viewed as different. And they did it in a non-threatening situation, and that offered entertainment and a community of shared interests and pleasures. So I hope that shed some light on how the musicians truly felt they paved the way for the civil rights movement. Thank you, and bye.
Let's turn him loose. Ladies and gentlemen, Chuck Berry, Sweet Little 16.
They're really rocking in Boston and Pittsburgh, PA. Deep in the heart of Texas and round the Frisco Bay. All over St. Louis and down in New Orleans. All the cats wanna dance with Sweet Little 16. Sweet Little 16. She just got to have about a half a million. Her wallet's filled with pictures. She gets them one by one. Becomes so excited. Watch her look at her run, boy. Grown-up blues, tight dresses and lipstick. She's sporting high-heeled shoes. Oh, but tomorrow morning she'll have to change her trend and be Sweet 16 and back in class again. But they'll be rocking in more.